residential. The word citizen is derived from the Latin term civis, which means resident of the city state. Article 5 to 11 under part 2 of the Indian Constitution deals with citizenship, single and uniform citizenship of whole nation. Citizenship Act of 1955 explains about the acquisition and loss of citizenship. There are 5 categories to acquire the citizenship of India. Number 1, by birth. Number 2, by descent. Number 3, by registration. Number 4, by naturalization. Number 5, by incorporation of territory. If we talk about by birth, a person who born in India on or after January 26, 1950 will be treated as citizen of India. Next, by descent. A person born outside India on or after January 26, 1950, if his father was a citizen of India at the time of his birth, will be treated as citizen by descent. Next, by registration. A person can acquire the citizenship by registration to the appropriate authority of India. Next, by naturalization. A foreigner can acquire the citizenship in application in terms of naturalization to the government of India. Next, by incorporation of territory. If some territories are added to the territory of India, the extended territory citizens will be treated as the citizen of India. So these are all the categories of acquisition of citizenship. Next, we move on to loss of citizenship. Number 1, renunciation. If the person voluntarily renounces his citizenship, it will consider it as the loss of citizenship. Next, number 2, termination. A person acquires some other country's citizenship, it will automatically terminate its existing citizenship. Next, deprivation. The citizenship can be acquired by false or fraud representation, concealment of material facts, or indulging in trade relationship with some other enemy countries will automatically deprive the citizenship of the nation. So these, if a person comes under these 3 categories, will consider the loss of citizenship. His citizenship rights will be lost. Okay, so these are the concept of citizenship of India. Now we move on to fundamental rights. Fundamental rights are enshrined in part 3 from article 12 to 35 of the Indian Constitution. It guarantees every citizen to enjoy their basic rights. So it is rightly described as Magna Carta of Indian Constitution. At present, we have 6 fundamental rights in our constitution. Number 1, right to equality. Number 2, right to freedom. Number 3, right against exploitation. Number 4, right to religion. Number 5, cultural and educational rights. Number 6, right to constitutional remedy. According to Dr. B.R. Ambedkar, right to constitutional remedy is the heart and soul of the Indian constitution. Hence, fundamental rights are justiciable in nature. Justiciable in nature, which means they are enforceable by court of law. So this is all about the fundamental rights of Indian Constitution. Let's move on to directive principles of state policy. Article 36 to 51 under part 4 of the Indian Constitution deals with directive principles of state policy. It provides guidelines and principles to the government to govern the nation. It can be broadly classified into 3 principles. Number 1, socialist. Number 2, Gandhian. Number 3, liberal intellectual. Under socialistic principle, it ensures the social and economic democracy of every citizen. Next, Gandhian. It helps us to develop the nation from very grassroots level, that is from rural to urban. Next, liberal intellectual. The citizen of the nation should get rid of superstitious belief and must develop the scientific temper for the progress of the country. It helps us to promote the social welfare of the people so that the government is duty bound to implement these principles while making laws. Right, Dr. B.R. Ambedkar described it as the noble feature of the Indian Constitution. And one more thing, they are not justiciable in nature, which means they are not enforceable by any court of law. This is all about the directive principles of state policy. Move on to fundamental duties. Article 51A under part 4A of the Indian Constitution deals with fundamental duties. In 1976, Congress party set up Sardar Swaran Singh committee to make recommendation on fundamental duties. So that 42nd Amendment Act of 1976 added some responsibilities to every citizen of India in our constitution. That is, we call it as fundamental duties. It is nothing but the responsibilities and dutifulness of every citizen towards a nation. Next, center-state relation. The Constitution of India, being federal in structure, divides the power of central government and state government under three heads. Number one, legislative relation. Number two, administrative relation. Number three, financial relation. Legislative relation under Article 245 to 255 of the Indian Constitution deals with the power of the parliament and state legislature to formulate the law for the whole nation. Next, administrative relation under Article 256 to 263 deals with the implementation of the laws which have already made by the parliament and state legislature. Next, we move on to financial relation under Article 268 to 293 deals with the power of parliament and state legislature to impose tax for the whole nation. So this is all about the center-state relation. Now we move on to emergency provision. The central government has been vested with an extraordinary power to deal with the conditions of emergency. So far we have three types of emergency. Number one, national emergency under Article 352. Number two, state emergency under Article 356. Number three, financial emergency under Article 360. So this is emergency provision of Indian Constitution. Next we move on to constitutional amendment. Amendment in the sense change, modification or improvement. Usually this term is associated with one or more changes made in the constitution of our country. Article 368 under part 20 of the Indian Constitution deals with constitutional amendment. It provides the power to parliament to amend its structure. Right, we have three types of amendment. It can be classified under three head. It can be amended by simple majority of the parliament. Next, it can be amended by special majority of the parliament. Number three, it can be amended by special majority of the parliament and ratification of half of the state legislature. So this is constitutional amendment. So the topic of Indian constitution is almost over. Hope it's pretty clear to all. See you in the next class with an interesting chapter. Thank you.